soul, our God. Our God is mighty for us always. We are not alone. We are not alone. Sing that again. Our God is mighty.
Love.
lift your voice and I'm loved by you. One more time. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord, I have tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. As
we sing those words tonight, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. We want your presence. We want to be able to see and experience your glory. What we're simply asking is that God, in this gathering amongst us tonight, would just work and move in a way that only he can, within our heart, within our mind, within our soul. The things that we so desperately need him for, he would touch. You know, God is omnipresent. He is everywhere. But as his people, we can call to him and ask that he would, in a special and an important way, come and be with us when we gather together. That's our privilege as his children. And so as we're singing those words tonight, I don't know if you've ever wondered what that means exactly or what we're asking for exactly, but that's simply it. You know, God, the Spirit of God, he can work and he can move and he can do things in your heart and in your life that only he can do. No song can do, no number of words could do. And so let's continue to sing and just make that our prayer. There's nothing that's better. There's nothing worth more than just to be able to experience God, to get just a glimpse of his glory, just a glimpse of knowing who he is and what he's all about a little better. So let's just make that our prayer as we sing tonight.
Comes free, and my shame is out.
Make that our prayer. Sing that out tonight.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
Can take a seat as we continue to worship if you'd like. If you'd like to stand, you're more than welcome to.
Pour out our praise, it's your praise.
Father, you are a great God who deserves all the honor and the glory that we could possibly bring, and much more. Lord, but the praise that we do possess, we bring to you tonight. We offer it to you tonight. Lord, we have no part in the glory that you deserve. Lord, that is all yours. So, Lord, we offer it and bring it to you tonight. And I pray that as we prepare now to get into your word, to hear from you and to receive from you, that as your word gets into our heart and it transforms us and it moves us into more and more the image of Christ, that our lives would also bring honor to you and glory to you. So, Lord, be with us tonight. Bless our night as you already have. Continue to bless it. Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, hey, before we continue, maybe say hello to someone next to you and get settled in as we go forward.
All right, everyone. Good to see you guys. Let's turn to Proverbs. Hey, Brinson. Proverbs chapter 3 tonight. Proverbs chapter 3, if you guys would turn there in your Bibles. And it's just awesome to get together, open up the Word, and see what the Lord has to say to us. I have been doing a little traveling today, so this could be exciting, what we're about to do, because I might say things that I did not plan on saying. I was actually down in Southern California yesterday and today, Calvary Chapel does a youth workers conference every year around this time of the year, and youth pastors and leaders from different churches gather together, and Andrew used to go to that with me, and we used to go to that when I was a youth pastor. I had a great time at it, but I got to speak at it last night, and I was so just excited because the theme of the whole conference was prayer, and it's really hard to actually talk to people about prayer. I don't know if you've ever tried it, but it's a difficult thing because I think a lot of us feel a lot of inadequacies when we're thinking about the subject of prayer and a prayer life. I haven't met a whole lot of Christians that have felt like, you know, that's an area I'm nailing it. So, you know, it's kind of delicate to talk about. But I was thankful for that subject being talked about at a youth workers conference because these are people dealing with junior high school, and college age ministries. And I think gone are the days where, I mean, we never could have really actually done any legitimate youth ministry in the arm of our own strength and might, but we might have had thoughts that we maybe could. But we are living in an era and in a time where it's like, unless God helps us, we got nothing. So the pull of the world is so strong, and their affections, you know, and all of that. So to teach and to consider for youth leaders how to pray, what a great subject. So we need to pray as well. And the other thing I wanted to mention before we jump into the word tonight is, you know, I shared with you guys a couple of weeks ago on Sunday morning that we are getting ready to this spring start a church planters school here in our church. We're looking for a small group of guys that are already, for the most part, already in pastoral ministry, like an assistant pastor, youth pastors, guys like that, who will then leave where they are currently serving, come here for about a year to get a little bit additional training in addition to all the theological training they already have, and then for us to, after a year, be able to send out into wherever they want to go and, you know, help fund them and everything like that to go plant and start brand new churches, which I think is very important. And we took a nice little step in that direction. You know, the guys have been, and especially Pastor Jeff has done a great job of putting together, I think curriculum's probably too strong of a word because it's not a class-based school. It's an immersion, immersing yourself into the life and fabric of this church and Jeff's counsel and training and stuff like that. But the curriculum is beautiful and everything like that. But one thing we were able to do this last week is they put together our first little website kind of thing. It's not even really a website. It's just a web page that's like an intake form for guys who are interested. So I was excited about that because there's a few guys already that I've talked to and said, hey, if you're interested, you know, because some of these guys say, like, I'm praying about planting a church. And I just want to be like, well, everybody prays about it. So are you ready to actually do it? And they get that look like, well, I don't know. You know, maybe in 2025 I'll come to your school. So I'm just excited about that. So I just wanted to pray tonight for our time in the Word, but also for that, because I think the Holy Spirit just needs to match us up with, because we're just looking for a small handful of guys. The Holy Spirit needs to match us up with those men that the Lord will want to then launch out. So let's pray. So Lord, we do pray and ask that as we look into your word, all these verses, all this truth, all this beautiful wisdom that you want to speak to us, we want to hear it and receive it just as it is, Lord, our Father in heaven ministering to our hearts as your children by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And then also, Lord, we just want to pray and ask that you, Lord, and I guess I'm just asking you right now, church, as we're praying this, don't let me just pray it. I want you to agree with me in prayer. Lord, we ask together that you really would bring us the right men, Lord, not just this year, but in the years to follow, along with their families, if they have families, that you are calling, Lord, legitimately to go out into this world to pioneer brand new fellowships that previously did not exist, that will now exist, Lord. We think, Lord, tonight our hearts smile and rejoice to think of the four people this last Sunday night out in North Salinas who gave their lives to Jesus Christ because Pastor Matt Gersondi preached the gospel in their brand new church, in a church service, and invited them to receive Christ. So we thank you for that, Lord, and we ask and pray that you continue to do more of that, Lord, here on earth. We trust you. We need you, though, Lord. Our strength is so small. So we pray that you'd help us in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Proverbs 3. We started last week going through the book of Proverbs and looking at really the life of skill. The word is wisdom in the Old Testament, but that's a word that can also mean a skilled life. So we ask the question, who wants to live a life of skill? God designed the world in a certain way. He's made certain rules that govern the world that we live in. There are often exceptions to those rules, but these are general rules that God has created and established. And so to live according to them is to live a life of great skill. And so that's what we desire, to live this very skilled life. Now, these first 12 verses of chapter 3, Solomon, as is the case with much of the book of Proverbs, is going to speak very honestly to his son. These first 12 verses especially are very beautiful and very applicable to our modern time. He's going to tell his son to trust God more than he trusts himself, to fear God by avoiding evil, to honor God with his money, and to appreciate God's chastening or discipline upon his life. But before he does that, he tells him or gives him an exhortation in the first four verses. So let's read it together tonight. My son, do not forget my teaching. All right, so we're Proverbs 3, verse 1. But let your heart keep my commandments, for length of days and years of life and peace they will add to you. Let not steadfast love and faithfulness forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, so you will find favor and good success in the sight of God and man. So really you have Solomon, as he talks to his son, he says a couple of things, verse 2 and verse 4, that are designed to help his son be attracted to the potential of a life of wisdom. And I think for you, if you could just try to get it out of your mind like this is some Bible-ese or something like that, and just look at it honestly, verse 2 and 4, and ask yourself, would that be the kind of life that I would like to live? Length of days and years of life, verse 2, and peace being added to me. Who wouldn't want to have that kind of life? And then verse 4, so you will find favor and good success in the sight of God and man. All right, so that's a beautiful life that Solomon is describing. Some of us, it might be good for us to just ask the question, is this the life that I have lived so far? And if not, then maybe we might say, okay, well, maybe there's some wisdom from God that I want to receive from him and begin to apply into my life in a brand new kind of way. But the thing that Solomon is really exhorting his son in is very simple. Notice verse 1, do not forget my teaching. Verse 1, keep my commandments. Verse 3, let not steadfast love and faithfulness forsake you. Verse 3, bind them around your neck. Verse 3, write them on the tablet of your heart. What Solomon is doing for his son is he's saying, son, you've got to really make sure that this is a really big part of your life, that you are in constant pursuit of the wisdom of God's word and the truth of Scripture. So really, I think what Solomon is saying to his son is, you want to be a person who is a Bible person. This isn't like a fashionable thing anymore. You know, I was reading through Revelation 2, and I came to Jesus' letter to the church in Ephesus in Revelation 2. And one of the things Jesus said to them is he said, you left your first love. You need to return to your first love. Repent and do the first works, the works that you did at the very beginning when you first started walking with me. So I didn't personally feel like, yeah, I've totally left my first love. But I just started asking the question, what were the first works? What were the first things that I did when I first started walking with the Lord? And it was interesting because as I just kind of sat there thinking about it, trying to let the Holy Spirit speak to my heart, there was one thing that came into my mind that I was like, you know, I don't do that as much. But when I first started walking with the Lord, there was no, you know, iPhones. There was no, like, digital computer that you just carried in your pocket all the time. And so, you know, I have, like, a phone that's got an app on it with a Bible on it and everything like that. But when I first started walking with the Lord, we didn't have anything like that. So when I first started walking with him, I never went anywhere without my physical Bible. It was just always with me. It wasn't like I was always, like, trying to, you know, appear really holy or righteous or something like that. You know, I'm not saying I went into the grocery store with it or anything like that. I'm just saying it was always like at least in the car or in my bag or just around because I never knew when I might have an opportunity to open it up and read it for myself, explain it to someone else, and just to get into God's Word. And I think honestly, we probably need to have, and so that for me, I was like thinking about it, I'm like, I'm going to bring that back a little bit more. You know, just, I know I've got one on my phone, but, you know, I have other things on my phone that distract me. So I start reading it, and then I'm like, ooh, but what about this? But when I'm in the Bible, if I get distracted, it's just like, oh, what about Revelation? Or what about Titus? Or what about Ecclesiastes? It's just other books of the Bible that distract me, and that's all good. So I just think that's a good thing for us to have. Solomon is telling his son, you want to aggressively pursue the Word of God. So, you know, not in any kind of legalistic way where you're just looking more spiritual than you really are, but I think as Christians we should want to have Bibles that are worn out and are just used because we're pouring into them and we want them to pour into us. Now there's a bit of the new covenant alluded to in verse 3 because Solomon tells his son, bind these words around your neck and write them on the tablet of your heart. In other words, get this word so in you that it's not just, you know, attached to you externally, but it's actually inside your heart. It's actually written on the tablet of your heart. Now, that's a difficult thing to do. It's very hard to change your heart. It's very difficult to actually get the previous thoughts that you had to be erased that are on your heart and to get God's word written upon your heart. However, the Holy Spirit can do this work. The New Testament says in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10, this is the new covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws into their minds and write them on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. So one of the beautiful things about knowing the Lord now on this side of the cross is that the Holy Spirit can actually write his word into your heart. So when you open it up and you're praying about it, you're considering it, he can take that word and he is slowly but surely, I believe, embedding it onto your heart, actually changing you from the inside out. So when you become a Christian, you're a new creature in Christ Jesus. But how many of you say, I'm a new creature, but I want to actually act like it, all right? It takes a while. There's a lot of things that need to be changed and transformed, but that's the Holy Spirit as you pour over God's word, writing it upon your heart, and he truly does it. He truly does it. Some of you just met me. You don't know me very much. You hear my story, and you're like, oh, you know, whatever. You haven't come that far, but some of you know me, and you're like, I believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. Okay? Because that's the Lord. He works inside your life. He changes you from the inside out. Now let's move on in chapter 3. In verse 5, he says this beautiful thing, very famous verse actually. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will make straight your paths. One of the hardest things to do for us as God's people is to trust the Lord. It's interesting. We really should trust the Lord most easily. The cross of Christ tells us that he always has our best interest in mind, even when it is costly to himself. But we more easily trust ourselves, our own perceptions, our own thoughts, and we also trust other people, the things that we see. But the Lord says to us, he says, no, you want to trust in the Lord. You want to lean upon him. Now that word trust is a beautiful word. It actually means to lie helpless, face down. So to just have this kind of like feeling like, I need help, I need grace, and I'm just here completely leaning upon and trusting in the Lord. But what we so often do, I mean, the New Testament teaches us that we're to walk by faith and not by sight. So there are certain things that you see, things that you observe, and you want to lean on that, don't you? But the Bible teaches us, no, you don't want to lean on what you see. You want to lean upon the God who you can't see, but who is more true and real than anything that you can see. In the Old Testament, there's a prophet named Elisha. You probably remember him. He had a servant named Gehazi, but we're not certain that this story actually had to do with Gehazi or not, because he kind of disqualified himself at one point. But he had a servant. Doesn't say his name in this story, but this young man, the Syrian army was coming up against Elisha to arrest him. And this young servant, he looks out of the door and he sees this huge army coming up against him. And he says, "Master, the armies, they're coming to capture us. They're coming to take us." And Elisha says to him, "Oh, don't worry. The army that's with us on our team is bigger than that army." And the guy kind of looks out again. He's like, "There's no other army. It's just one army. There's no other army that's for us." And Elisha then prays. He says, "God, would you open his eyes? Help him to see." And his eyes were opened, and he saw the invisible, it had previously been invisible, armies of God. And he looks out, the army of the Lord. And God delivered Elisha and protected him and his servant. But so often we see what we can see, and we trust that. We lean upon that. But the Lord is saying, no, don't trust that. Don't lean upon your own understanding, but trust me. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Trust the Lord with all your heart. And so here, just a beautiful exhortation from Solomon to his son. And I think that for you here tonight, I know that trust in the Lord is one of the hardest things to do. And so I just want to speak frankly to you and just say, you got to trust the Lord more with your life. You got to lean upon him more with your life. I need to lean upon the Lord more with my life. Trust him. Lean upon him. Notice also he says in verse 6, acknowledge the Lord. That means, other versions say it differently, submit to the Lord or seek his will for your life. Think about him in all your ways. Listen for God's voice in everything you do. So just every step of your life, you're acknowledging the Lord. And when you do these things, notice what happens. He makes straight your paths. Now the phrase that kind of has caught my attention is both in verse 5 and 6. Trust the Lord with all your heart, and in all your ways acknowledge him. You know, I think I like to trust the Lord a little bit with part of my heart, or with part of my ways. I think about that time when Jesus called Peter to come out of the boat and walk out to him on the water. You can't do that kind of thing part way, can you? It's either all the way or none of the way. And that's really what the Lord is asking us to do. And there will be moments in your life where there's a huge question. Will you trust the Lord? I was talking to this young guy last night, him and his wife, they were very discouraged in the ministry that God's asked them to do. They've been a part of 3 different churches now that have all, you know, kind of imploded or stuff like that. And I don't know the details, and I hope that it wasn't his fault, but he wasn't making it sound like it was. But him and his wife, they were just kind of discouraged and just battling on in ministry and everything. And he had just been sharing with me, he's like, you know, we, to come here and to do what we're doing now, it's hard, it's difficult. And I was like, well, where'd you come from? He told me, he said, you know, I'm like, what did you leave? He's like, I had a county job and I quit it. Now I'm putting in septic tanks and I'm doing it. And I'm volunteering at this church trying to run the high school ministry. And I'm just listening to him and I'm putting it together like, oh, you quit everything to go move to this community, to help this church. And I just looked at him and I'm like, hey, I don't know if you ever want to plant a church, but all I know is there's certain things that I can teach, but that kind of trust in the Lord, I can't teach that. You either have that or you don't, and you're crazy, man. So if you want to come to Monterey, because I'm looking for crazy people. And That's trust. And there will be moments in your life where the Lord looks at you and says, do you trust me? Do you trust me? Will you say yes to me? Will you take that step? Will you lean upon me? Or will you calculate and add, figure it all out in your own understanding, which is fine for us to have. Solomon is writing a whole book on how to give his son wisdom and understanding. Understanding's great. However, there are times where we're not supposed to lean on it. And we're supposed to just simply say, I don't get it, but I trust in the Lord. All right? So you read the whole Bible and you try to figure out how much would have actually happened if they'd have trusted and leaned on their own understanding. Not much. You have to trust the Lord for the thing to do great things for the Lord. And then he goes on in verse 7 and he says, be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. I think one of the secrets to life is to not be wise in your own eyes. We don't have to fake it. You don't have to pretend like you know a lot. You can just say, I don't. I need wisdom. You see, the thing that happens with the wisdom of God is you actually start behaving wisely. And things start working out. And when they do, you know what is so tempting? You start to say, I'm pretty smart. And the thing you need to know about God's wisdom is it's on loan, yo. So you have to continually have a submissive heart before the Lord that says, you know, all this stuff that I'm applying and doing and all that, like, it's not from me, it's from the Lord. And it's to not be wise in your own eyes. There's no need to pretend. You just have to continually humble out and get that wisdom from the Lord. When you do, notice verse 8, it'll be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. There's just this therapeutic role of the wisdom of God in a person's life. This is, I think, verse 8, so much of the world is chasing this. Healing and refreshment. And we do so much to try to get it. And I think sometimes we refuse to acknowledge that sin in our lives and rebellion against the wisdom of God that he's given to us is actually causing some of the anxiety, the turmoil, the lack of rest that's in our hearts. Not all the time, but sometimes. Then he says in verse 9, he says, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of all your produce. Then your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be bursting with wine. So he looks at his son and he says, son, you know, your wealth, you got to honor God with the first fruits of it. Now, the people of Israel, they had this thing where they gave God the first fruits of all their crops, the money that they made. They gave God the first portion of it. A lot of times it was the first tenth of it, but they gave God the first portion of it. Giving God the first portion of it, the first fruits, is difficult for a lot of reasons. I mean, for one, you have to really trust the Lord to give him the first fruits, because he didn't ask for the last fruits. He asked for the first fruits. So when you give God the first, it's kind of like you're trusting, like, okay, I'm giving you the first fruits. I'm really trusting there's going to be some second fruits and some third fruits that are going to come. I'm giving you the very first, the best. I'm laying that down before you. But what he tells his son is, as you do, then, verse 10, your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be bursting with wine. In other words, God will never be outgiven. So as you give to the Lord, as you open up your, not just your heart, but as you open up your wallet to the Lord, as you give, the Lord will give back to you. He'll provide in your life. And of course, this is found all throughout the Old and the New Testament. Malachi, the prophet, gave a prophecy where the people of Israel were actually for a season robbing God. That's what God said to them. You're robbing from me. You're stealing from me. They said, how are we stealing from you? He said, you're robbing from me because you haven't given the tithe. That was their tenth that they gave to God. And so he said, bring the full tithe into the storehouse, Malachi 3, verse 10, that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test, says the Lord, if I will not open the and see if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there's no more need. I'll rebuke the devourer so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil, and your vine in the field shall not fail to bear, says the Lord of hosts. So time, we don't have enough time for all the people in this room who have in their lives given to the Lord and then watched the Lord give back to them abundantly. We don't have time for all those testimonies, but that's how it works. You give and the Lord takes care of you. He provides for your life. Now sometimes the way that he gives back to you sometimes it is his, at the very least, provision, and sometimes above provision upon your life. But I think the Christian heart says, because there could be a temptation with something like this to be like, okay, so apparently God is the best investment that there ever was. So, you know, rather than invest in stocks or something like that, I'm going to invest in God. And that's what I'm going to do, and he'll make me rich or something like that. That is an attitude that gets crushed by the gospel, doesn't it? Jesus gave and gave and gave and said, I'll just keep on giving. All right, so that's a heart of someone who has embraced Christ in their lives. But what are some other ways that the Lord, you know, fills our barns with plenty? Well, when we give and we open our hands, I think one of the strongest idols that exists is the worship of money and wealth. So when we give, it loses its power in our lives. Our trust in the Lord, talk about trusting God, it increases when we give to the Lord. My little nephew, he's 5 years old, but he sometimes doesn't want to go to church on Sunday mornings, so he'll come in with my sister and they'll sit there. And recently, during the service, the offering bag was passing by and he had a dollar in his pocket. And he had brought it with him to buy a donut after church. But the bag was coming, and he just felt compelled, like, I want to. And so he asked my sister, he's like, Mama, can I give this? She's like, if you want to. And so he came by, and he put the dollar in. And as it was going down the aisle, he started thinking, and he looked at my sister, and he's like, but my donut. And, you know, and he looked at the bag, and she's like, once it goes in, it's in. You can't get it out. It increases your trust in the Lord. It's like a scary thing when you do that and you give to the Lord. It's like, oh man, whoa, there he goes. You know, kind of thing. But to know the Lord is faithful, he's going to watch over my life. So I would encourage you to, you know, grow in this area of your life. If you haven't discovered that kind of joy, I'd encourage you to do it. Dave Ramsey gives counsel on finances for all kinds of people, but especially believers. And he says, you know, you want to save 10% of your income if you can. You want to give 10% of your income. You want to be generous. And I think that's a great and biblical and good place to begin for a believer. But something to work towards maybe for some of you. He says in verse 11, he says, my son, do not despise the Lord's discipline or be weary of his reproof. For the Lord reproves him whom he loves, as a father, the son in whom he delights. Now, this is quoted in Hebrews. It talks about the fathering nature of God. So he's talking about all these blessings. You trust in the Lord, he makes your paths straight. You know, you pursue his wisdom in your life. You're not wise in your own eyes. It's healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones. You know, you give the Lord your first fruits, and man, he fills up your barn. It's just so great. You know, he's saying all these great blessings about knowing the Lord. But here, one of the blessings of knowing God is his discipline upon our lives. When this is quoted in Hebrews 12, the next thing that's said is, it is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? So you've probably had the experience of God busting you over something. It doesn't feel comfortable, but it's actually very good for your soul to have God correct you over something. His discipline is good and right and pure, and it changes us from the inside out. I'll never forget when I was in sixth grade, we had a earthquake drill. You know, I grew up around here, so we always had earthquake drills. That was our big thing. And, you know, we'd have to get under our little desks, you know. And my friend Daniel Anaru, he gave me a firecracker right before the fire drill. And I thought that would be a fun time to light this firecracker. And so I did, and I thought I'd get away with it. I don't know why I thought that. It was because I was in sixth grade. You're not thinking very clearly at that time of your life. And I got caught and everything. And then the horrible part was, as I'm sitting there in the principal's office or the vice principal's office or whatever, I just concocted this elaborate cover-up story, you know, and like just the tale was just horrible, you know. And in my mind, I'm like, oh yeah, this is great. I'm getting out of this, you know. And I'm just like lying and telling all these, you know, this guy heard a high school kid was going to come down and throw it in the window. And who told you that? Well, this Sally, you know. And I'm just like doing this whole thing. And so finally, you know, they're like, look, and I got in trouble for it and everything. And I went home and I received the discipline of my father. And I'll never forget, he told me, he said, son, if you'd have just said, yeah, it was me, you know, I'd have given you one level of discipline. But you cannot be a liar. So you got a whole new level of discipline now that's coming. We had this huge hill behind our backyard that was just covered, this huge hill covered in weeds. And he's like, those weeds? You know, because I got suspended. So he's like, you think this is going to be fun, not going to school? You're going to be praying to go back to school by the time these days are over with. And that was helpful to me. Helped me learn. Helped me grow. The discipline of the Lord is good in our lives. The Lord reproves him whom he loves. That's God's love when he disciplines you. Now, verse 13, he talks about some of the blessings of wisdom. Blessed, verse 13, is the one who finds wisdom and the one who gets understanding. For the gain from her is better than gain from silver, and her profit better than gold. We've got to be convinced of that, don't we? Because we live in a world where we think one of the greatest things we could ever get is profit from silver or profit from gold, money, wealth. But here he says, no, what you get from wisdom is much better than that. I think that we need some rewiring to understand what really good stuff is. What's really actually valuable. And we're going to learn that a lot in Proverbs as we move through the Proverbs. He goes on to say in verse 15, she is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. So you have things that you want, things that you desire, but getting wisdom should be the chief pursuit because it's so much better than anything that you can own. Long life is in her right hand. In her left hand are riches and honor. So wisdom, she gives with both hands, right hand and left hand. So many of the things that we want in life, they give with one hand, but they take with the other hand. And wisdom, though, just is continually giving both-handedly. And her ways, verse 17, are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who lay hold of her, and those who hold her fast are called blessed. So wisdom is personified like a woman here, and Solomon's saying to his son, you need to pursue her, treat her well. She's a tree of life. The Lord, verse 19, by wisdom founded the earth. By understanding he established the heavens. By his knowledge the deeps broke open and the clouds dropped down the dew. He's saying God created the heavens and the earth with wisdom. So who are we to say we don't need the wisdom? If God used it, we want to use it. And then also, he's kind of saying as well here, God created this world that we live in, and if you want to be connected to it, don't we live in a little community here that wants to be connected to nature? Well, what he's saying here is, you really want to be connected to nature? Obey the laws that God has made in nature. That's a great way to fit within nature and be connected to it. My son, verse 21, do not lose sight of these. Keep sound wisdom and discretion, and they will be life for your soul and an adornment for your neck. Then you will walk on your way securely, and your foot will not stumble. If you lie down, you'll not be afraid. When you lie down, your sleep will be sweet. Do not be afraid of sudden terror or the ruin of the wicked when it comes, for the Lord will be your confidence and will keep your foot from being caught. One of the things that living by the wisdom of God will do in your life is it will give you a clean conscience. Because what he's saying here is that when you live contrary to God's word, he says, people like that, they don't sleep as well as they could. People like that, you know, when you're trusting the Lord and you're walking in his ways, when you lie down, you won't be afraid. You know, when people are in like all kinds of sin and rebellion, they got to sleep with one eye open, right? Who's coming to get me? Who's going to come pay me back for the evil that I've done? But when you live a righteous life, you're just able to say, I'm good. Nobody's coming to get me. I'm doing fine. And you lie down, you sleep well, your conscience is clean. And, you know, isn't a clean conscience a beautiful thing? And so he's just saying, hey, look, this is the beautiful life. You live a life that's obedient to the Lord. Your conscience is clean. Do not, verse 27, this is how we treat other people. Do not withhold good from those to whom it is due when it is in your power to do it. Do not say to your neighbor, go and come again. Tomorrow I'll give it when you have it with you. Do not plan evil against your neighbor who dwells trustingly beside you. Do not contend with a man for no reason when he has done you no harm. So a little bit there from Solomon to his son on how to treat people. So if we have the power to do good, then we got to do it. And if we have it with us, we want to let someone have it. But one of the things that is just kind of in my heart about this little passage as I was just kind of studying and preparing for this, I got to verse 29. Do not plan evil against your neighbor who dwells trustingly beside you. And I don't know, my first reaction to that is just kind of almost like comedic, you know, like, all right, church, you know, so if you're planning on like, you know, blowing up your neighbor's house, don't do it, you know, kind of thing. I'm like, well, how does that apply? And I felt like the Holy Spirit just spoke to my heart that there are, I don't know, maybe one or two of you, a handful, that you've been very evil to your literal neighbor, and you need to stop. The Lord is looking at you tonight, and he's saying, you need to quit that. You're not being the light of the gospel that you need to be here on earth. Stop treating them that way. They're not perfect. You're not perfect. You need to stop. And you need to begin to be gentle with them and kind with them. So I don't know who that's for, but I'm just trying to be obedient to say what needs to be said. And then he says in verse 31, do not envy a man of violence and do not choose any of his ways. So, you know, there are these violent people out there that it's the weirdest thing. They can almost, you know, you look at them and say, I there's something about that that I admire and that I like. And so he says, don't fall into that trap, for the devious person is an abomination to the Lord. So we're learning what God feels about them. But the upright are in his confidence. The Lord's curse is on the house of the wicked, but he blesses the dwelling of the righteous. Toward the scorners he is scornful, but to the humble he gives favor. The wise will inherit honor, but fools get disgrace. So in other words, he's saying God has an end for those violent people. So as much as we might be drawn to them, we're called to be a different kind of people. Now in chapter 4, he goes on, and I love this little portion because he just really talks like a father to his son. He says, hear, O sons, a father's instruction, and be attentive that you may gain insight. For I give you good precepts. Do not forsake my teaching. I like that from Solomon because he's just looking at his kid and he's just so confident as he's talking to his sons. And he actually does use a plural for his a lot of times it's just son, but here it's all of his sons. But he's very confident that what he's saying is really good. He's not half-hearted about it. He says, this is really good stuff that I'm saying to you. These are good precepts. And I think a Christian father has to have that real conviction inside of his heart, because there will be times where the world will say to you, no, the stuff that you're sharing with your kid from the Bible, the wisdom that you're giving from God's word, that's really actually not good. That's really not helpful. But you have to have a conviction in your heart. No, this is good. This is right. This is pure. And so Solomon had that. And then he begins to reminisce in verse 3. When I was a son with my father. So how many of you, your dad loved to reminisce about things? And you just start rolling your eyes like, oh, here we go. I can't tell you how many times I heard about the Tustin High Tillers from my dad and the football team he played on and the championship game that he was in. I was, okay, Dad, tell me about the Tustin High Tillers. You know, so Solomon here, he starts reminiscing. I'm just getting it off my chest apparently tonight. But Solomon here, he reminisces about a time that his father spoke to him. Now, who was his father? David. King David. All right, so this is cool. We get right here. He's saying, my dad, David, used to say this to me. And here's what David used to say. But first he says, when I was tender, the only one in the sight of my father, my mother. So before his brothers and sisters were born, when he was a firstborn child, before they were born, when he was still the only child, he says, so when I was very young, he taught me, verse 4, and said to me, let your heart hold fast my words. Keep my commandments and live. Get wisdom, get insight. Do not forget, do not turn away from the words of my mouth. Do not forsake her, and she will keep you. Love her, and she will guard you. The beginning of wisdom is this: get wisdom. And whatever you get insight. Prize her highly, and she will exalt you. She will honor you if you embrace her. She will place on your head a graceful garland. She will bestow on you a beautiful crown. And David really did live a life of incredible wisdom. Counterintuitive wisdom so often. You might remember that time when Saul, the king, was chasing him, wanted to kill him. And David and his men, they ran down into the wilderness of En-Gedi and they hid in a sheepfold. It was a cave. Hundreds of caves, thousands of caves down there. But they hid in a cave. And Saul went looking for him with his 3,000 troops. And Saul got to a point where he wanted to take a rest. And he goes into the cave that David is in. And the odds of that, I mean, it's not like Powerball odds, but it's... It was long odds. And he's there inside the cave. The soldiers are on the outside, so they're making all kinds of noise. And Saul, the light and everything, he's disoriented. He doesn't know that David's in there with his men. And David's men say to him, this is the day the Lord said, the Lord spoke to you, that he would deliver your enemy into your hand. And the thing about that is that by looking at it, it really looked like, yeah, oh man, God did this. All the caves Saul could have gone into. He came into your cave. Now you get to kill him. This is the day the Lord had spoken of, that he would deliver your enemy into your hand. But here's the trick. God never said that. He had never, ever said that. He had never said that to David. He had never said, I'm going to let you kill Saul. And so David had the wisdom of the Lord. And he went out. He had a lot of wisdom. He went out and he just cut the corner of Saul's robe instead. And Saul went out of the cave, and David felt so guilty about that, and he followed him out. He said, forgive me. He says, if I would have wanted to kill you like you think I am, I would have not just taken the corner of your robe, I would have taken your head, but I didn't do that. And he put himself in a real vulnerable spot when he came out of that cave. But that was the wisdom of God upon his life, very Jesus-like. And so here, Solomon is saying, my dad used to teach me about that kind of wisdom, and he said that if you submit to it, then, at the end of it, verse 9, she'll place on your head a graceful garland, and she will bestow on you a beautiful crown. Now, that's a figurative kind of thing that David said to Solomon, but David actually experienced that literally in his life, didn't he? When he was 30 years old, the southern portion of Israel, they put the crown on his head. And then when he was 37 years old, all of Israel put the crown on his head because they just watched his life and they said, man, we want to follow after you. God has put wisdom in your life. And so I think perhaps David had something to do with that beautiful night in Solomon's life when he first became king and he offered all those sacrifices to God. He offered like 1,000 bulls to God. And in the middle of the night, God spoke to him and said, what do you want? And he didn't ask for riches, wealth, victory. He said, I want wisdom. I want wisdom. I think David had something to do with that. So it's just an exhortation concerning how badly we should long for wisdom, because here's what you want. At the end of your life, I don't think any of us are going to have like a literal crown. If you show up next week with a crown on your head, come on, that's not what we want. But at the end of your life, you want the people in your life to just look at you like, man, well done. You're a blessing. You made it. You did well. You gave life. You want the people in your life to feel that way about you, right? You want the people at your funeral to not have to really like fudge the details all that much, right? You know? That's what you want. You live a life of wisdom, and that can be done. Hear, my son, verse 10, and accept my words, that the years of your life may be many. I have taught you, verse 11, the way of wisdom. I've led you in the paths of uprightness. When you walk, your step will not be hampered, and if you run, you will not stumble. Keep hold of instruction. Do not let go. Guard her. She is your life. So he's continually admonishing his son to carefully gather the instruction of the Lord, the wisdom of God. And I think that in one sense, what he's saying to his son is he talks about accepting and keeping hold and not letting go and guarding. There seems to be the accumulation of wisdom, but then also the application of wisdom. And that's another part of it. It's one thing to receive it. It's another thing to apply it. I think that one way that is helpful to us in applying wisdom is to have other believers in our lives that help us to have perspective and to know how to apply God's wisdom in our lives. Believers that are more mature than us, but also believers that we can just have fellowship with and talk about the things of life, and that they can speak into our lives and help us apply God's word into the situation that we're in. This morning I got to grab breakfast with a friend of mine down from Oregon. I think you guys know Pastor Jason Beal. Some of you do, at least. I've had him speak here a couple times. But he was down in Southern California at this conference also, and he brought his youth guys and stuff. And so we figured out that we'd be down there at the same time. And he's a good friend of mine. We have good fellowship together very quickly. And so I didn't have a lot of time. He didn't have a lot of time, but got up early this morning and we went out to breakfast. And so we're sitting there, and very quickly, I'm talking to him about things that I'm wrestling with, trying to figure out, trying to think about. And then he's telling me things that he's going through and that he's wrestling with, thinking about, trying to figure out. And out of my mouth is coming just Bible stuff for him, and out of his mouth is Bible stuff for me. And nothing I didn't know. Nothing he didn't know, but applying the wisdom of God's word to our situation at that exact moment. Solomon is telling his son, you got to apply God's word, God's wisdom. Do not enter, verse 14, the path of the wicked, and do not walk in the way of the evil. Avoid it, do not go on it, turn away from it, and pass on. For they cannot sleep unless they've done wrong. They are robbed of sleep unless they have made someone stumble. For they eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. So here's what Solomon is saying in verse 14 through 17. He's saying sin is highly addictive. And he says it gets to the point where there are some who they can't even go to sleep until they do wrong. And they're robbed of sleep till they go make someone stumble. They can't even rest. They got to go out and do something bad. So for us, we want to say, okay, verse 14, I do not want to enter into it. You see, one of the things about this wise life that the Lord is teaching us about is you can't go back and forth. You can't like just say like, okay, I'm going to kind of be about God's wisdom and then I'm going to pursue the world's thing for a while and expect to have the good outcome that's described here. So he says, you just don't want to go there. They eat the bread of wickedness. They drink the wine of violence. But, verse 18, the path of the righteous is like the light of dawn, which shines brighter and brighter until the full day. The way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know over what they stumble. I love verse 18. I've loved it for a lot of years. Years ago, I had an older woman in the church. She gave me this verse. A lot of people give me verses. I don't know if that happens to you, but it happens to me. A lot of people give me verses, different words. I have something I'd like to share with you. Sometimes it's really helpful. I've been around the church for a very long time. Sometimes it's helpful, sometimes it's manipulative, you know, things like that. So I just always, you know, I'm kind of like, okay, I want to hear from the Lord. So you have to have a pure heart. You shouldn't, you know, the Bible teaches in 1 Thessalonians, you can't despise prophecies. You don't want to quench the Spirit. So I'm always open, but guarded. So she had a verse for me, this older woman in the church. And sometimes those older women, they can be sneaky. They're trying to get you. So, you know, I was probably a little guarded, you know. I'm like, okay, you know, let's see what this is. You know, it's kind of like a roundabout way to say, like, you should do this. I don't like it, you're doing this, you know, kind of thing. But she shared this verse with me. I opened it up, you know, I took it home. Oh, she had written it down. I opened it up, took it home. And I was really blown away by it. It just kind of came at the right moment, the right time. I just knew this is the Lord that gave me this verse. The path of the righteous is like the light of the dawn, which shines brighter and brighter until full day. What it had application for to me in my life at that particular moment was church work is hard because there's the world, the flesh, the devil, they're all very real. So, you know, you ever heard the phrase, two steps forward, one step back? If that's the way it was in church work, I'd be stoked. That'd be great. Two steps forward, only one step back. Sometimes it just feels like you're just so hard to make progress and to see progress in people's lives and growth and change, gospel preaching, all that. And she shared that with me, and I just knew that that was the Lord speaking to me about my life, about our church, that you just keep moving and things just, the sun just gets brighter and brighter when the day starts. It's just kind of dim, but then it gets brighter and brighter and brighter until the perfect day. And as you just serve the Lord, Nate, you know, the sun will just get brighter and brighter and brighter, and you just keep going. And I just love that. It's always been a real help to my own heart because I'm just like you. Don't we want to see things happen immediately? Right? And what he's saying here is, no, you walk this way, and slowly but surely, you're going to see the brighter and brighter thing happen in your life. I heard Rick Warren one time. He's a pastor in Southern California, very famous, well-known. You probably heard of him. But anyways, I heard him talking to a bunch of church planters one time, and he said something that I was like, whoa, when he said it, I was like, that's bold to say right now. But he's older. He's been around for a while, so you could say that kind of stuff. And he just looked at this room full of church planters. He said, some of you guys are in your first, like, 3 years, and you got, like, 5,000 people in your church. And he said, I just want you to know I am not impressed. I was like, what? And he said, the reason I'm not impressed is because there's no way that's real. You just had a bunch of people transfer to your thing that you started. The only time that ever happened was Pentecost. 5,000 brand new Christians, you know, boom. And he said, what I'm impressed with is that faithful, slow obedience over time where the Lord adds to the church daily, those who are being saved, people grow, people are being transformed, but just steady. And I think for you, you should set your heart and mind upon that and just in your own life. You want to slowly but surely just grow more and more into the image of Christ. This is how the Lord changes us and grows us. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says that he grows us from one degree of glory to another. So I've known some people in my time in the Christian life that other people have really put down and said, you know, I don't think much of them spiritually. They're kind of carnal. They're kind of fleshy. But I've known where that person's come from and their history. And I've said, well, actually, I'm rather proud of them because the level of glory that they were at when they began, they were at such a disadvantage. But God has really helped them in their lives, and they've come up. They were so far down, they've come up to here. Maybe you started up here and you only climbed a couple of steps. And you might feel like you're higher, but man, they've really made a lot of progress in their lives. That's how the Lord grows us from glory to glory. The light which shines brighter and brighter, he says, until a full day. All right, let's close this out. Verse 20. My son, be attentive to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Let them not escape from your sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life to those who find them and healing to all their flesh. Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flows the springs of life. Put away from you crooked speech and put devious talk far from you. Let your eyes look directly forward and your gaze be straight before you. Ponder the path of your feet. Then all your ways will be sure. Do not swerve to the right or to the left. Turn your foot away from evil. So notice first, the whole body is involved with wisdom. The ear, the eye, the hand, the feet, the mouth, everything, all the flesh involved in the application of God's wisdom upon our lives. So your whole body needs to belong to Jesus, all right, everything. But then he says, there's something really important here. Verse 23, keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. Our hearts are so easily influenced. They're so easily drawn away. And I think Proverbs 4, verse 23 is one of the most important verses in all of Proverbs and in all of God's Word when it comes to our growth as people. You have to protect your heart and guard your heart because we are so attracted to sin and stuff that's out of bounds and off limits. You got to guard your heart. Watch over your heart. You'll be tempted every single day of your life. So you've got to go through that process of guarding and protecting your heart. I heard this beautiful study by a man named Wayne Grudem. He's a seminary professor, but he actually was involved in the translation of the Bible I'm teaching from, the English Standard Version. So he's brilliant in the original languages. He's a brilliant man, great theologian. Really sweet guy, too. And I heard him teach about this verse. And he talked about this time when they were translating the English Standard Version. It was a hilarious story. And he said that the way they did it is they rented a hotel somewhere. I can't remember where. It might have been out in Phoenix. They rented a big hotel, and all these, you know, brains, you know, came. And they're there, and they got together in this room, and they had the original texts in front of them. And they just went from Genesis to Revelation. And they had, like, these certain rules of, like, a certain amount of breaks every day that they would have, and then, like, a certain system of, like, voting on each word and raising an objection. Oh, no, I don't think that's what we should put, and, you know, things like that. But they were just, it was very organized and structured. But can you imagine how tedious that would be? I mean, I can't imagine. I just could never do that. But, you know, he was there. He's doing this whole thing. And he said, you know, it was 8 in the morning till 5 at night every day with a 2-hour lunch break that they would just be studying like that. I mean, that is intensely, you know, draining in the mind. And he said after a couple of months, he got to this point where, because in the morning his habit every day was to get up and open up the Bible for himself, hear from the Lord, and pray. And so he said, I was just tired after a couple months. He says, I was just so tired. And I just started thinking, you know, every day we're reading the Bible in the original language all day. And so maybe I could just take a break from my morning times. And he said this went on for a week and a half or so. And his wife, her name's Margaret. And she said, Wayne, you're a little cranky. And he's just like this sweet guy. He's like, Margaret said. And he said, you know, and I realized I was not keeping my heart with all vigilance. I needed to get back to that time and protect my heart because it was prone to wander. So I just heard that because to me, he's a spiritual giant. If I'm hearing that from someone like that, then I know I have to really guard my heart and be so serious about keeping it because sin wants to take me out, wants to take you out. So let's keep our hearts with all vigilance. Amen? All right, so Lord, we thank you so much for your word. You love us so much that you would say these things to us. So we pray that you'd help us to grow, to be transformed, Lord, and please watch over our souls and help us, Lord, in our walk with you. We want to grow, Lord, in wisdom more and more. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, God bless you guys. Have a great rest of your week. See you Sunday.